For God loved the world to such an extent that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him would not perish, but shall have everlasting life. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son. And he gave him the condition that whoever believes on that Son would not perish, but they will have everlasting life. Verse 17, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. See, we don't quote that part. We quote the extent of his love, but not the intent of his love. He did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. Why did he send him? But that the world through his Son might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned. Did Judas believe in him? You sure you want to say yes?
Yes.
All right then. Okay. He who believes in him. What it said? What did it say? Why then have we taught each other to condemn one who believes in him? Okay. But he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only. The name doesn't mean Jesus. The name speaks of the character. He doesn't believe in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world. So we define it, the condemnation. And men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds be exposed. And we think that's drinking rum, that's keeping woman, that's hidden coke and whatever else you call it. No. Because the Pharisees did none of that. Self-righteous deeds are evil deeds. If you sit every day and make a decision in yourself that I will not, and I will not, and I shall not, and based on the things that I have decided to do, that makes me righteous, you're evil. If you sit and you have a list of things in your head that you say, if I do these things, that makes me righteous, you're evil. Because righteousness is never of works. It is by faith. When Israel had to bring a sin offering, in the book of Leviticus, the man who sinned had to bring an offering, which is an animal. He brought the animal to the priest. The priest examined the animal to see whether the animal was without blemish. Stick with me here now. Who sinned? The person or the animal? Who did the priest examine? I thought he examined the person. All right. The man sinned. God said, the man must bring an animal without blemish, a lamb or a goat. Bring the animal, it must have no flaw. Who sinned though? So why is the priest examining the animal and not the man? Because the man has come knowing he sinned. You don't have to examine him because you know where he is. So it doesn't matter how you show up to God, he knows where you're at. We don't mind how right you feel. Whenever you show up to him, he said, your righteousness is filthy. So I will look at the Lamb, not you. And according to my knowledge of the Lamb, you're righteous. But hold on, the Lamb didn't sin. And whenever we come to the presence of God saying that I have done these things, you are saying, I didn't bring a lamb, I brought me. So examine me to see if I'm qualified. And the most righteous is still unrighteous because God's level of righteousness is way too high. Okay, so we're still in John 3? Okay. So the evil deeds are not the sins you commit. That's not just the evil deeds. The evil deeds are also the righteousness you create. Jesus did not come to condemn the world. He was not sent to condemn the world. Therefore, he was not sent to condemn Judas. He wasn't sent to condemn Peter. He wasn't sent to condemn the Pharisees. He was sent that the world through him would be saved. Okay. When man fell in, according to what we put it, in the Garden of Eden, he had this tragedy, he disobeyed God, so he's now in trouble. And for so long, I hope by now, you would discover that God is not accidental in his nature. He doesn't do things and then try to fix it without, okay, I didn't expect this to happen. So Adam is in the garden. I don't expect him to do wrong. But just in case he does wrong, I'll come. That is not the nature of God. God had a specific assignment. And I lay thinking about it, evangelists. What in the world would make God create people? Why? He doesn't need people. Why make a world? Why do this? God has no need. Do you believe that? Don't listen to people telling you foolishness now. Who turned the sign? Anybody tells you that God needs you, you're God. So don't let people talk foolishness to you. God doesn't need you. Because last I checked, he saved you when you didn't even know to get to him. Now that you save, he has a need. So what have you been doing before he saved you? God has no need. If ever God has a need, he's no longer God. Because it means he is weak and he is inclined to be in a position to receive from someone. Okay. So he doesn't have a need. Why then would he make people? Why would he go through all this issue to make people who know it's sin and all that? Why would God do something like this? More than that, he made every single angel. Why would he cause one or allow one, whatever we want to put it, to become Satan? Why would God go through all this? I'm thinking all the time, God, now talk to me, please. Help me to understand why you would do something of this nature. Why didn't you just make everybody, if you choose to make them, permanently good? Why didn't you make angels who would never do wrong? Because if angels never did wrong, then he said, stop, son. I am love. Say, uh-oh. Say, uh-oh. Whatever you say in America, say it. Okay. What he just said is what? Okay. He said, because I am love, I have the right then to test the extent of my love. Don't miss this today. If I exist alone, then I have been incomplete in my nature. I can help you here now. For me to say I am love, there has to be something existing out here that I could direct my love to. Let me show you how important we are now. And the thing that's outside of me must not be the exact person that I am. Because if it's as good as I am, then my love isn't tested. I am permanently pleased. But I could only be true love if there's something on the outside that I made that is exactly opposite to who I am, and I could still love it. You talking about you love your husband, I gonna hurt you bad today now. The only way we could truly say that God is love is when love comes face to face with what it hates. And then love says, I know I hate that, but because I am love, by intention, I will suffer to fix that. All right, if you're married, start shifting, start going further away. Don't go close now. Take some space now, because the body got hot in here. Love says, because I love, I will see an object that is flawed. And instead of beating the object to become perfect, I will suffer to fix the object. How many of you in here, including me, could love like that? Or do we love with a list? If you do, then I could love you. God said, I have to show me how much I love. So he allows human beings to be, he created them, knowing what they behold. He made the angels knowing what they behold. And in spite of all of that, he said, all right then, I see the flaws, I see all the errors, but watch what I'm going to do. I am going to still demonstrate who I am in the midst of everything. So Jacob, you trick your brother and you got the birthright. You're a trickster, you're a crook. You're supposed to be in jail. That's what you call deception or conning people. But because you're a convict, I wouldn't make the covenant with Esau. I made the covenant with you. Because I have a covenant with the disqualified. Moses, you killed a man. You're a murderer. I'm not going to go to find one who is without flaw. No. I'm going to seek out the murderer when he's hiding. I'm going to tell the murderer, I would work with you, boy. Let's go and free my people. And the murderer will say, I shouldn't be qualified. And he said, good. Why then do we then bring ourselves in a position in the church, the modern church, to feel that God no longer works with the disqualified? And we work so hard to qualify ourselves for God to use us. And the harder you work at God using you is the less useful you are to Him. He did not come to condemn the world. So he created man. He allowed Satan to do what Satan had to do. Then he says, I will come and I'll defeat you. The Bible says that he came to his own and his own did not receive him. Who was his own that he was talking about? Thank you, evangelist. He came to Israel and Israel did what? Rejected him. Now, if Israel rejected him, meaning, what does that mean? Israel did not accept him to be Messiah or the Son of God. If Israel doesn't accept him as Messiah, then it's obvious that Israel will be lost. They don't accept him. But the only way he's qualified to be crucified on this cross is if somebody from Israel says he is. Because they didn't accept him for who he was. If you don't accept him for who he is, then how could one of the priests say he is the Son of God? If the priest said that, the priest is in trouble. So Jesus had to find somebody who would know who he is, who would believe on him, and then that person had to tell others who he was so he could be killed. Who's that person? Judas. For years, the church, whenever there's Passion Week, we call it Easter. Easter is not a Christian day. All right. Tell them your pastor said that. It was a mistranslation of the King James Version. But the season when, of the Passion, when Jesus was about to be crucified, in that time, Jesus began to tell his disciples, this is what's going to happen to me. Now look at the Lord. Whenever he says something, it is so. All right? You notice I'm taking my time and shouting much right now? Because what I'm about to tell you, coming to the end, I can't just shout to start this thing. We got to talk straight first. He tells his disciples, this will happen to me. I will be betrayed. Did he say that to them? By one of you. The 12 of them start asking, 12, say 12. It wasn't one. Everybody said, Lord, is it me? Why they ask that if they are so good? Why would 12 men, including Judas, say, Lord, am I the person who would be walking with you? Who you would rescue from the storm? Who you give power to cast out demons, to heal the sick? Who you would be so inclined to teach me the parables and give me mysteries? Am I the one who would turn around and sell you out? Then the Bible said Judas started talking. He said, hey. Judas says, am I the one? He said, you have said it. And it's better for that man if he were not born. Why did this happen? A woman anointed Jesus' feet with the most expensive thing of the day, her life savings. And the disciples said, come on, man, you didn't have to waste this thing on this man. We could have used this for the poor. That's a good cause. And Jesus rebuked them. We're about to go to work. Upon rebuking them, the Bible said, then Satan entered Judas. After he was rebuked. Then Satan entered. Before Satan entered, Judas never had a problem with Jesus. But Satan entered Judas. And Satan entered Judas, and Judas then betrayed. The name Judas means praise. It's from the Hebrew word Judah, which means to praise or to celebrate. Okay, let me give you 2014 now. The day Satan enters praise, you betray Christ. So we clap on Sunday, we dance on Sunday, we play on Sunday. But if you sing, dance, clap, whatever you do, and your attitude is competitive, your praise has been infiltrated by the adversary. I just said something to you, and I said one more time. If you sing, you dance, you clap, or anything to sound better or to play better than somebody else, your praise has been infiltrated by Satan, and you are betraying Christ. Because praise is not by performance. It is by conviction of what he has done for you and who he is to you. So if I'm singing for him, how am I listening to you? If I am working and I'm going to work and say, God, I'm working as unto you, then I'm looking at the neighbor's promotion. Praise is reserved for God. And God never has competition. So when praise is exclusively to him, then there's no external force that affects your praise. Satan entered the praiser. Because the only way Judas could betray Christ is if Satan goes into the person. The question then becomes, who betrayed Christ? Before Satan entered this man, he did not betray Christ. But let Judas sit in the pew for a minute and let me talk about another one first. The Roman Catholic Church has been built on one disciple. Who is he? Do you know him? You mean Paul? Good. Upon this rock, they say the rock is Peter. I will build my church. So the Pope has to trace his spiritual legacy or genealogy to Peter. Because that's the rock. If ever the Pope says that Peter is not by right one who would have laid hands down the line to him, he is disqualified from being a pope. They have to prove that he by right inherits Peter's position, because Peter, according to the Catholic, is the pope or the first bishop of the Lord's church. So the church has applauded Peter and said that on the day of Pentecost, when the men said these men are drunk, who got up and talked? Peter. And Peter said, we're not drunk as you suppose, but this was spoken of by the prophet Joel, that in the last days I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And Peter preached. And so the church exalts him, forgiving or forgetting that before he said that, he was in hiding. And before he was in hiding, he was lying, saying, I don't know this man. To betray somebody means that I have information that I give away at the expense of that person. Or I violate their trust. That's what betrayal means. For example, if we decide we're going to steal somebody's money, we steal a person's money, and then I tell my friend, listen, we would never tell who stole the money. Minister Boris, we can talk. This between me and you, we'd never tell who stole this money. And then the police come and hold me, and I say, well, they say, boy, listen, I let you go free if you tell me who took the money. And I say, he did. I betrayed him because he had confidence in me and I sold him out. I didn't say to the police, I don't know him. Okay. Peter, on the other hand, walk with this man. Talk with this man. Peter, by Holy Ghost, said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Peter turned and said, I don't know him. You use your conscience and tell me who is worse. You wouldn't be sinning. Who you think is worse? The friend who could look at you in your face and say, I don't know who she is. Hold on, man. Is this the same Peter that I grabbed my hand, reached my hand out to and hold him and he was sinking in the ocean? And pull him up and walk with him back to the boat, and you would now say you don't know me? But Peter is qualified to preach. But Judas, because he never preached after he did what he did, we say he's in hell. Why is he in hell? Because based on my standard, if a friend betrays me, she going to hell. That's all we do. We use our system of judging to say that if somebody does wrong to me, then that person goes to hell. I'm about to ask you some questions today that may trouble you, so I'll have to take my time to explain them. Jesus said every sin in Matthew 10 shall be forgiven of men. All. 10, 11, or 12, thereabout. All sin will be forgiven of men. All. Except which one? Except which one? So let me ask you the question one more time. Did Judas believe in Jesus? Did Judas ever say to Jesus, you're not the Christ? Did he ever say to the Holy Ghost, I don't believe you any Holy Ghost, you're just a fake? Did he ever say that? Okay, so if Judas never blasphemed, why is he in hell? Talk to me, somebody. But you will say, like one guy said to me, but he committed suicide. And if you commit suicide, automatically you go to hell. Let me ask you the question one more time. All sins shall be forgiven of men. Except which one? Okay, so I said to the man, since this is your reasoning, sir, is suicide blasphemy? You answer me. me ask you the same question. If I commit suicide, that blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. If your answer is no, then is suicide forgivable? But apostle, if I hang myself, would God forgive me? You answer the question, is it blasphemy against Holy Ghost? If you say no, then there's one sin that could be forgiven. And I ask the person the question, what if I drink 40 sleeping pills? Who said I died right away? Because I know where you're coming with. What if he didn't get to ask for forgiveness? Who said he didn't? Don't look at me with that tone of voice, because the body gets worse. You didn't reach the bad part yet. We are not qualified. Now, let me help you now. Let me help you here now. God said the same measure you use to judge your neighbor, I will use to judge you. So if the person says suicide is without forgiveness, and that person down the road, for whatever reason, ends up doing it, would they be forgiven? Should they be forgiven? The safest position to take as a believer is that without judgment. Look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. And I say to you one more time, this but the third time I told you, if I can't preach the church empty, I am empty. So if somebody needs to get up and run out of the church because I'm talking heresy, leave now and I'll keep talking. I need to give you the good part. So I could make the part right there got you trouble. So let me give you a nice part, then I come back to the hard part. The priest, whenever you brought a sin offering, he had to examine it. Did I say that? Did I say that? Okay. Somebody go to Matthew chapter 27 for me. Matthew 27. I said to you, the priest had to examine the lamb or the goat. It couldn't have like damaged feet and cleft ears, and it couldn't have any flaw. It had to be a pure, thorough animal. According to Leviticus, that was the priest's job, Aaron and his sons. When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people plotted against Jesus to put him to death. This is after Judas would have come and given the wonderful kiss. Let's read that first. Matthew 26:47. And while he was speaking, he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now his betrayer had given them a sign, saying, whomever I kiss, he is the one. I said to you, somebody had to make the Israelites know who Jesus was. The spiritual person, which is the anointed one, is who they were after. They knew the face of the person, but they never understood the anointing of the person. Now that right there is important even for this church. You could get so casual with the face of a person that you miss the anointing of a person. Wife and husband, watch it. You should the most eligible person to dishonor you is your spouse. Because they become so familiar with who you are that they miss who you are. You have to constantly remind yourself, my man is a man of God. My wife is a woman of God. I don't mind how she acting. Because the day you get so familiar with an anointing, you will dishonor the person. And then you would have dishonored the person. Job was a righteous man by God's standard. And the woman he lived with tell him, why don't you curse God and die? I thought she would have said, I know you to be a righteous man. But we don't want to talk there to get spouses upset today now. This isn't a good day to get you mad. So let's go back to Judas then. Where are we? Verse 49. Immediately he went up to Jesus and kissed him, agreed him, and he said, Rabbi, and kissed him. But Jesus said to him, What would Jesus call him? Friend! Why have you come? This word friend is not the word filio, which means my emotionally attached brethren, as we call it. The word friend in this case was the word my comrade or my partner. Why would Jesus call Judas his partner after the kiss? What was the arrangement that they had that Judas didn't know about? He did not call him friend like you, my friend. He didn't say that. He said, you are my workmate. We are working together to accomplish something. Judas, you are doing the will of the Father. I warn you, say if you want to leave this church, get up now because it's about to get worse. If there was no Judas, there would be no crucifixion. Because somebody had to say who the anointed one is, not the face. Judas kisses him and says, Rabbi, and he said, my partner, why did you come? And we know the rest. He's arrested. Now let's go to 27, verse 3. Then Judas's betrayer, seeing that he had been what? Condemned. Did Jesus come to condemn anybody? So who condemned Judas? You see, it's possible for you to do stuff according to how the church folk tell you, and you feel that you are disqualified forever from God dealing with you. Jesus did not come to condemn the world. He told Judas that. So where did Judas get the condemnation principle from? Why are you living your life and beating yourself with a stick that is not in God's hand? Who said you can't preach? Who said that you cannot sing? Who said you cannot function in this church because of what you did? Why do we constantly disqualify ourselves by people's standard? And God is saying, I did not show up in your life to condemn you. What? Okay, maybe you could ask your neighbor this, because if I ask you, you'll get upset. Ask your neighbor, why would God save you? Ask them, why would God save you? I said to ask your neighbor a question, and I'm going to run around this church and fight today. Ask them, why would God save you? To make you useless. Why would you talk about being saved and then fight against God working in you? You are qualified if only by salvation. So Judas felt condemned. Okay. But look at the twist, the curveball now. So he goes, verse 4, to the chief priest, saying, what? Oh, hold on. Judas, seeing that he'd been condemned, or he was now found according to what Jesus said, you do it. He realized I'm doing it, but the one who did it. He was remorseful, and he brought back the 30 pieces of silver. Now, if it's your Bible, underline it, highlight it, but stir that in your head. He brought back the 30 pieces of silver. Okay? And when he brought it back now, he gave it to the chief priests and elders, saying, what? Read what he said. What did this man say? I have sinned. What do you call that? So where did we get it that Judas never said he was sorry? I have sinned. That was his statement. He didn't stop there. What he said? By betraying what? Okay. Ask your neighbor, who had to examine the lamb? See if they're listening to me since I've been talking. Whose job was it to examine the lamb? Who? Okay. What did Judas just say about the lamb of God? Okay. Okay, so the high priest of Israel was saying, he is not the son of God. He is blasphemed against God. He is guilty, and you can't kill a guilty lamb. Don't miss this. You cannot kill a blemished lamb. The lamb must be without fault. And the chief priest said, this lamb is flawed. We can't kill him. They were asking to kill him, but when he was dirty in their eyes. And Judas, whose name means celebration, says, this lamb is without fault. He is a clean lamb. He's an innocent lamb. Therefore, he's qualified for the sacrifice. Judas. Okay. Hebrews chapter 7 said Jesus came not of the Levitical tribe. He was a priest according to the order of Melchizedek, which is of Judah. If he's a priest of Judah, then another priest of Judah got to qualify him. Oh my God. Woo! And God chose the one who was most disqualified to say Jesus is clean. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh. Oh. You mad for that? Tell your neighbor, catch yourself. Say, catch yourself. Let me talk. Get on the Bahamian AJ. What you say? Catch yourself. Don't get mad for this. I know you're upset with how you treat Judas over the years. But Jesus was not a priest according to Levi. So the Levitical priest could not say he was right. Judas Iscariot is from a place in Judah. Jesus is of the conquering lion of which tribe? So which priest had to qualify him? A priest was not qualified to make a sacrifice unless he was trained and approved by another priest. And look at the priest who God will choose to say, this man is clean. Watch this. I am dirty. So we now need to go to the tree. If ever a high priest goes into the Holy of Holies with sin, he dies. Why do you think Judas could live through the experience then? Did he not say, I have sinned? If a high priest goes to the Holy of Holies, how could he live? They had to tie a bell on his foot, on his clothes. And if the bell don't ring, he'd been in there with sin. Judas could not live. Because he was the priest who said the lamb is clean, but I am not. So Judas, okay, let me rewind. The priests of Israel know the law. If you're not clean and you go before the Holy of Holies, you are dead. Judas looks at the most holy one, kisses him, and says, I am wrong. After that, if he said, I am wrong, I have sinned, how could that priest live? The lamb without blemish had to die. And the priest with the error had to die. Both the lamb and the priest died at the same on the same moment. The same event. Okay then, tell them, son, they didn't hear what you just said. Both men hung from trees. Both the priest and the lamb. Since you're ready for the next part, the priests of Levi, when they died, there was a rope tied to their feet, and you pull them out by their feet. Judas was yoked. He had a partnership. His rope was round his neck. He still had a rope that pulled him out of where he was. All right, so let's go. Can we go a little further than this? You'll survive by in a few minutes. You'll be all right. I betrayed him. The priest said in verse 4, what is that to do with us? You see to it. In other words, you deal with that. Then he threw down the how much? The 30 pieces of silver in the temple. Where did he throw it? Okay. And he left. And he left. And he left and went and hanged himself. But the chief priest, which is from the Levi tribe now, took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful to put them into the treasury because they are the price of blood. And they consulted together. And what did they buy? The potter's field to bury what? The Bible said we were strangers. Oh my God. Unto God. Whose 30 pieces of silver was it? Judas. Whose money bought the field? Okay, the field of strangers is called Gehenna. Hold your neighbor's hand because you're about to get a heart attack right here. It's called Gehenna, which in translation is hell. Judas, whom you condemned, put his money in the temple to buy a place called hell where strangers were buried. Buy in Greek means to redeem, to get back. Ask your neighbor, do you still want us to put him in hell? Oh. Look at whose money got you here. Gehenna is not the place where we think about it, is with the serpent and some snake, somebody with a pitchfork. That's not what Gehenna is. Gehenna was a place where the Israelites and the strangers, they used to throw them in. When they died, just dump them like mass burial. And that's why Jesus said the worms don't die there, because there were so many people. Judas' money was used to buy that place so Israel could own it and bury strangers. Okay, we were not of the tribe. We were not of the people. Romans chapter 11 said that we were wild. And God had to blind the Jews and therefore graft us in. We were strangers. And somebody had to buy a stranger or pay for where they were. Whose money bought it? Did Judas try to give the priest the money back? What they told him? We don't want it. Therefore, it wasn't the priest's money who bought it. It was unacceptable. Jesus' blood was shed. Judas bought a field where other people's blood was also shed. But the disqualified man paid for those who were disqualified. All right. You can get that by next week, Tuesday, this time. By next week, Tuesday, this time. I promise you, you'll get it. By this, check your watch. 4 o'clock. Next week, Tuesday, you'll understand what I just said to you. Judas's 30 pieces of silver were used to purchase a place called Gehenna, which according to Isaiah, I think it was a Jeremiah, God said, one day I will redeem this place. I will get this place back. Whose money got it back? Jesus have mercy. Let me ask you again. God, according to Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 6 to 9, said, one day I will get this field back for me. Whose money bought it? So this guy is in hell because he paid for the field that God said will get you back. Church people, how in the world you could put your life in church people's hand? They got the nerve to curse the man who bought the place for them to be redeemed. Oh, you feel it's now start happening? It's not now it started to happen. Let me show it to you from the Bible then. He bought the field. They bought the field where strangers were buried in. Therefore, that field is called the field of blood to this day, Gehenna. This then was fulfilled, that which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying what? And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of him who was priced, whom they of the children of Israel priced, and gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord directed me. Peter one day looked at Jesus and said, Lord, you're not supposed to die. Jesus said, get behind me. Who? What did Jesus call Judas when he kissed him? What did he just call Peter? Who are we promoting? Peter was not doing the will of the Father when he said you shouldn't die. He said, Judas, Peter, you are an offense to me, meaning you are my adversary. That's what Satan means, adversary. So Jesus says, get behind me. You are my adversary. You don't care about the things of God. You care about the things of men. When did Jesus tell Judas that? That's it, Pastor Mel. We owe Judas an apology. So now they have a question. We sit into Matthew 27. Now they have a debate. The guy said, listen, I have to release somebody to you. Yeah, I have to release one of these men. It's the nature of Rome to release somebody to you. Who do you want? Barabbas or Christ? Or Jesus the Christ, the anointed one? Who did they choose? Okay. And the church would normally cry for that. That's it when you start crying, right, Daniel? You cry bad for that part. Oh my God, look, they would rather choose a thief instead of Jesus. You don't realize that if they didn't choose Barabbas, you're dead. But who's Barabbas? Say Bar. Let me teach you Greek. Say Bar. Say Abba. What does Abba mean? When the Lord was teaching you to pray, he said, pray this. Abba. Which is daddy. Which is master, father. Barabbas. Bar means son. Simon Bar Jonah, son of Jonah. Bar Abbas. Okay. Who do you want? Who do you want me to release to you? Bar Abbas, which is son of father, or Christ, the anointed one? Bar Abbas is not anointed to die. Christ is, means anointed one. They said, give us son of father. Let Christos die. Why didn't he ask about the other thief? Why he chose the one with the name Son of Abba?
Oh my God.
So they released Barabbas and they kept Christos because the anointed one was anointed to die. Barabbas is gone. Barabbas is gone. He's free. We walking smiling down the road. He realized the value of his name, nothing. After all, I just escaped. Okay. Barabbas rolling free down the road, and Christ is left in the hot water. Let's go further. I want you to see this part right here. So they asked him, for he knew that he'd handed him, verse 18, over because of envy. Verse 19, while he was sitting in the judgment seat as the governor, his wife said to him, have nothing to do with this man. That's when Dr. Jamal Bryan got in trouble. Have nothing to do with this man, for he's a just man. For I have suffered many things today in a dream because of this man. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitudes that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? They said, what? Barabbas. Pilate said to them, what then shall I do with Jesus called the Christ? They all said, what? Then the governor said, why? What evil has he done? But they cried out all the more, saying, what? Tell your neighbor, we're getting there. When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, but rather that a tumult or a riot was rising, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. But he wasn't a high priest, so he ain't qualified to say that. You deal with it. Oh, verse 25 is the number of 5 times grace. Listen to what they said. Where are we, Ashes? What did they say? All the people said what? All Israel shall be saved. Romans chapter 11 verse 28. What did the Israelites say? His blood be on us and our children. What does the blood of Jesus do? In their anger, they made a promise. If anybody has to be guilty of his blood, let it be on us. Telling him, but that's what he wanted. They made an ignorant request. Let his blood be on us. And the Lord said, that's exactly what I want. Now I could die. Because Israel, by their statement, has asked me to wash them.
That's how Jews are saved. Oh my God.
That's it, son. Thank you so much. There you go. Preach now. Get a mic and start preaching. How are we without the shedding of blood? Sin is never taken away. What did they ask for? Let his blood be on us. Paul writes to the Romans and said, all Israel shall be saved. The answer to the question is why? What did they ask for? They never asked for his body. They asked for his blood. Because the Passover, God said, put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, and when I'm about to kill the firstborn, I will pass over those that have the blood. Israel said, put his blood on all of us. And the Lord died. Because Israel will be saved. You ain't got to worry about that. Their fathers and their forefathers made a request before the Lord died. Okay, the lamb's blood is what God was interested in. So they said, let the blood of the lamb be on us. Let the blood of the lamb be on us. Because when the Father is passing over, he will not hold a sin against us. Why? Because the blood of the lamb is on us. The blood of the lamb is on you. And the church. Okay. Come for me, son. Come for me, son. The governor was not an Israelite. The governor went to the water, and what did he do? Pour it. I don't want blood to be on my hands. The wife said, leave this man alone. Okay. Pilate, who's the governor, by his action said, I don't want grace. I don't want anything to do with you. I don't want sin to be forgiven. I wash my hand of the blood of this man. He is not of that people. The Israelites didn't ask for water. Let his blood be on us. We don't want anybody to wash us of anything. Because let the blood be on us, Pilate, not you. Because the blood was not for you.
Jesus. Oh my God. Who turned the sign? Who turned the sign? Who had? Okay, son.
So the condemned one sent the son of the father free.
Right. Say it again. So who? The condemned one.
So the condemned one.
Right.
Set the son of God free.
Free. The condemned one did that.
Which is the accusers of the brethren.
What did they have to do? Let him walk free. Explain it to them. Let me hear what you said. The condemned one had to release Barabbas. Woo! Now I'm about to ask the church, why do we still have Jesus in chains then? Because we bind him with stuff in our head and limit his ability to function. When he already had the 30 pieces of silver to buy, the field was already purchased. It wasn't Judas's price. It was the price of Christ. Judas was just the hand. Because a Levitic, a priest of Jude, a priest of Israel, Jesus is the high priest. A priest could not deal with the strangers. He was only the priest of this people. Judas, because he was disqualified. Let me help you further. Judas was of the tribe of Judah. The others were Galileans. They didn't like each other. So Judas was already an outcast. And the outcast, his name is celebrated. All right, the church missed that because he's really talking about Judas. The outcast, his name means to be celebrated. And you crying because people don't like you? No, the outcast is celebrated. I throw a party when people hate me because the outcast is celebrated. The one who is despised is loved by God. It is when my mother and my father forsake me, meaning those who should have my back, that's when he holds me in his hands, because God waits for man to let you go, the condemned. He waits for them to release you so you could walk into him. God doesn't play tug of war. That's ma'am. I think I could go home with this last scripture right here. Matthew 19. This one could send you home. Tell your neighbor, this could send you home to glory or home to your house. Because some of you may get a heart attack now. I know where you go. Either to glory or your house. Matthew chapter 19. Lord, keep me near the cross today. Oh, Lord, help them. This is about to get rough. This is going to send you home right here. So the Jesus now, the rich young ruler comes and starts talking. He said, hey, sell what you got. Give to the poor. The boy left sad. Verse 23. Matthew 19:23. We're still trying to find Judas. Then Jesus said to his disciples, assuredly, I say to you, or if you check, let me just interject because this is classes now. If you check the law, the King James Version will say verily, verily. You see that? The original language is amen, amen. Why he said it twice? Let me show you how serious Jesus was in fulfilling the law. According to the law, if you make a covenant with somebody, you have to say amen twice. So whenever, according to the law, if I'm going to sell you my house, and I sell you for 20,000, and I say amen, once, I have the right to take my house back, because I didn't say it twice. Amen, amen binds you. So Jesus, even in that aspect, fulfilled the law. By his speech, he said, amen, amen. Whenever he's about to teach them something that sound, he said, amen, amen. This is covenant language now. Okay. Hey! I love it. Sundays are my best days in the week. Surely I say to you, weary, that it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Did he say it's impossible? No. He said it's what? Hard.
And again I say to you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of... Now we have to deal with this. The church said, Jay-Z lost. He could never get saved. Anybody rich can't get saved. The eye of a needle was a place where the camels used to walk through in Israel. It was a, right, an arch. So he's saying it's easier for a camel to go through that than for a rich man to be saved. It was a place, not a little needle in your house. It's literally a place where the camels would go in the city. Where are we now? Okay. When his disciples heard it, verse 25, they were greatly astonished, saying, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said to them, "With men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible." Yet we go talking about what God wouldn't do, what God would do. Who God wouldn't save, who God would save. But with God, everything is possible. Okay, what were they asking Jesus about? Who then, verse 25, can be saved? Isn't that a question they asked? Listen to Jesus' response. With men, it's impossible. But with God, anybody could be saved. That's what he's saying. With man, it can't happen. But with God, anything is possible. 27. Then Peter answered and said to him, "See, we have left everything to follow you." Because there's a young man now who didn't want to leave everything. So Peter said, "See, we left everything to follow you. Therefore, what will we have?" I love Peter, boy. So Jesus decided, since you asked me the question, I will answer you. "Verily, verily, or assuredly, I say to you, that in the..." Say the word. What is the regeneration? It can't be now. It has to be when the Son of Man returns. In the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of His glory, you who have followed me will also sit on what? 12 thrones, judging what? Who was he talking to? The 12 apostles. Who was one of them? What did he say Judas will do? There is a throne that is set for 12. And he said to the 12, "The 12 of you shall be on these 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." How could Judas judge them from hell? Lunch break, coffee break. This is coffee break time. Coffee. Come get a mic. Get a mic. This over. Oh, coffee break. We need a coffee break.
No, we always thought that Judas went to hell and Apostle Paul replaced him. That's what we always thought.
Yeah, that's what we were taught. So, and Matthias, yeah. They were taught Matthias replaced him and then Judas, because they had to vote. Matthias was voted in. He wasn't appointed in. And he never did anything of significance. But did Jesus tell Matthias that he would sit on a throne? Who was he talking to? 12. Judas didn't do anything yet. Jesus said, "With man, it's impossible for one who betrayed me to be on a throne. But with me is the one who's disqualified. Look at the throne Judas occupies, Judah. He knows then how to deal with Judah, which is praise, the tribe of praise. He knows to deal with them because he lived the life to show when Satan enters, what happens?" Judas is qualified to talk to them. He has a throne. I came by to tell somebody today that I don't mind what you did. God has still reserved a place for you. And you need to stop condemning yourself and your neighbor, because the mercies of God are from everlasting to everlasting. You could never do more than God could do for you. And God has an intention to bless you in spite of. Don't you listen to these condemning church people. Jesus said, "The 12 of you will judge the 12 tribes of Israel. Because why would my friend be lost, but my foe, Peter, be saved? Flory. Who did Jesus call his enemy? He didn't tell Judas that. He said, "You, get behind me, Satan." The Bible said Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, but yet I love you so much that I will restore you." But Judas, who we call friend, cannot be restored. That's the church reasoning. The 12 of you will judge the 12 tribes of Israel. This part, Pastor Reginald, is where you got to start eating chicken right here. This is the chicken part right here. 11 men ran when Jesus was arrested. Right, AJ? Everybody scatter. Bushcrack, man gone. See, I got my Bahamian boy. We could talk our language. They're gone. Watch this. Reg. Peter ran at the sight of the high priest. Judas went to the high priest and began to preach on Jesus' behalf. When the 11 were scared to go to the high priest, the one who you put in hell went to them and said, "This man is innocent." Now you tell me the kind of preacher Judas is, boy. You think he no scaredy cat? Judas went to them and said, "You are wrong. I am wrong. This man is innocent." Peter said, "I don't know him." Praise will always preach for you. Oh my God. Oh my God, have mercy. Praise will always preach for you. If you could find anybody in your life who knows the quality you have, who knows the virtue of who you are, they will always speak for you. Praise will always speak for you. All right, Pastor, what are you saying? I don't care what you're going through. I just said it to you. You don't need to go to God with a tear and a sorrow. No. I said praise will always speak for you. It doesn't matter what you're going through, church. Whenever you go to God, let praise do the talking. Because God inhabits the Judah of his people. Yes. Yes. Oh my God. The devil says, "Don't praise God. You know what you did yesterday. You know what you did last night. You know what you did this morning." Because he understands that praise will always speak above your fault. Yes, sir. That's why, let me show my tithe on that one. That's why when your children misbehave and they know you're coming home, they try their best. "Daddy, how are you, Daddy? Mommy, I love you." Why? Because praise will always speak for you. This church needs to understand the power of praise. Praise creates an office, a council, a meeting with God. He said it, "I live in the praise of my people." The moment you begin to praise God, Judas was not hiding. He never hid. Judas walked up in the face of the high priest and said, "This man is innocent. My name is praise, and I shall begin to do what my name says." Judas praised God in the presence of God's enemies. Yes. Jesus, have mercy. Oh. And if you think that part is rough, Judas praised God to death. Yes. That's what he did. After he said the man is innocent, he died. After he acclaimed who God was, he died. Some of you still living because you haven't told God who he really is yet. Yeah. If you could only get a clear picture who God is, you will praise yourself to death. Yeah. Glory to God. God is after us praising him to death because he takes pleasure in the death of his saints. And Judas was never called an adversary. You looking at how he died. And God is looking at the fact that he did die. Jesus. Praise will always give you a meeting with God. Even when God don't want to hear you and you begin to praise him, he shows up. The woman went to the governor and she said, "Master, master, I needed you to help me." And the governor didn't listen. And she went back again and she said, "Master, master." The moment that she began to consistently elevate the master, he had to turn around and listen. Praise will give you an audience with God. Why don't you put on your attitude then of gratitude and begin to bless the name of Jesus? Where my musicians at? Begin to tell God. Go ahead, son. Fix my mic for me. Why don't you go ahead and begin to tell God and begin to stand in the position of Judas and say, "I am wrong, but he's right. I am unrighteous, but he is righteous. I don't mind how I look. It's about the lamb, y'all. It's about the lamb." Judas directed their attention to the lamb. But we come to church trying to get the attention on us. They didn't hug me today. They didn't kiss me today. They didn't tell me I'm a good pastor. They didn't tell me I'm a good singer. They didn't hold my hand. They didn't pray for me. But Judas said, "Forget about me. The lamb is righteous." Because it's the lamb who takes away the sins of Judas. Oh, glory to God. And there's coming a day, the Bible said, when there'll be no more tears in their eyes. Judas cried after he gave the speech, but he wouldn't be crying then. Because God said, "Because of your praise attitude, I have a throne set up for you." And of all the disciples, there's only one who would sit in humility. For real. Because he knows what he did. He knows what he did, but he knows which tribe he's from. And the tribe of Judah has been given the mandate to praise God. They have it in their bloodline. Judas was born a praiser. Judas inherited the attitude of a praiser. So even though he was wrong, he still had the right attitude. "I am going to declare the Lamb to be right." You've been trying your best to get God to hear you. You've been doing all you can for God to get God's attention. And God said, "You're using the wrong means to get my attention. You're crying to get my attention. You know, you're getting my comfort. But when you want to get my attention and you want to get my celebration, get the attitude of Judas. Begin to praise me. Begin to praise me." The Bible said, glory to God, the Bible said that Judas saw he was condemned and still went and spoke about God. You missed that. Judas felt condemned but still spoke about the Lamb. Judas felt rejected but still spoke about the Lamb. The 11 never went after him. They left him to go and he still went and talked about the Lamb. The same people who killed Jesus listened to Judas. Because there's something about a child of God. When you got the attitude that says, "I know that I'm guilty. I know I'm condemned. I know I'm rejected. Even if God don't want me, I will go to the adversaries and I will still talk about my God in heaven." When you feel rejected is when you should praise God the loudest. Glory to God. I love God. I love the Lord. And I love the attitude of Judas. The attitude of the praiser. The attitude of the praiser is condemnation, rejection, self-condemnation, hurt, anger, rage, bitterness, shame. Nothing will stop me from praising God. Won't you just get that attitude in this church today and lose your mind for a second? I'm not asking you to be pretty. I'm not asking you to look pretty. I said lose your mind just for one second and begin to develop the attitude of Judas. Somebody get a crazy, ridiculous, unexpected attitude of praise. Yeah, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Somebody needs to forget about all of the distractions and the issues and the condemnation and the rejection and go before
the enemies of God and tell the enemies of God, I will still bless him. Somebody needs to go. Somebody needs to go. Somebody needs to go. Before the adversary of God. Somebody needs to go, I said. Before the enemies of God. And look them in the face. And declare God to be righteous. I said, somebody needs to go up in the devil's face today. And tell him without fear. Without reservation. My God is able. My God is righteous. My God is still the conquering Lion of the tribe of Judah. My God is still the everlasting Father. My God is still, work with me, AJ. My God is still the one who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that I could ask, according to the power that works in me. My God is still the one who could see me in condemnation and still build a throne for me on the other side of glory. My God is still the one who could look at my sin and still call me righteous, because he is the conquering Lion for the tribe of Judah. My God is still the one with mercy, with grace. Yeah, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, we give you glory. 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 I will bless the Lord at all times. That was Judah's attitude, y'all. That was Judah's attitude. I will bless the Lord at all times. That was Judah's attitude, y'all. Even when I feel condemned, I will still go before the priest and I will tell him that he is righteous. And I will tell them that I am condemned, but not him. He is still the spotless lamb. He is still the righteous lamb. Yes, he is. He is still the one. He is still the one. He is still the one. You need to stop looking at yourself and try to feel right. Talk about the lamb. If you could go to God with the lamb and say, I don't come in my name. I come in the name of the lamb, Lord. I come presenting the lamb to you, Father, because the lamb is always righteous. The lamb is always pure. And because I come with the lamb, I shall be forgiven. I shall be washed. I shall be made white. Yeah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hold the neighbor by the hand and tell him, if you don't have the strength, my blessings on you, son. Hold a neighbor by the hand. Bless him, Father. Give him celebration. I said, hold a neighbor by the hand. Say, if you don't have the strength to praise God, let me do it for you. Begin to bless God for your neighbor. Begin to bless God for your neighbor. Yeah, Lord. I say, begin to bless him for your neighbor. I say, begin to bless God for your neighbor. Begin to bless God for your neighbor. Begin to bless God for your neighbor. Celebrate the person who may feel condemned. Celebrate the person who may feel rejected. Celebrate the person who may feel abandoned. Yeah, Lord, we give you glory. We give you glory. Yeah, we give you glory. Jesus, Son of David, we give you glory.